So out of an abundance of caution, the U.S. put a pause on the Johnson & Johnson COVID vaccine yesterday. We've been talking about it all morning. Six women developed blood clots following their dose. So we're going to bring in Dr. Keith Armitage, an infectious disease specialist with University Hospitals. He joins us now with the very latest. Doctor, thanks for being with us. Obviously, this is top of the headlines. Everybody's kind of wondering if they've taken this vaccine, should they be worried? And what kind of side effects should they be looking for?
Yeah, well, good morning. Now, thankfully, this blood clot occurrence is very, very rare. It's about one in a million. So I think, you know, level of concern should not be great. All the cases have been in women under age of 50, and all the cases occur between, you know, 7 and 14 days after the vaccine. And people should look for sudden headaches or you know, sudden leg swelling, that sort of thing.
Doctor, let me ask you this. The women that you just mentioned, so these six women are of childbearing age, right? So this, could this suggest that it may be hormonal? And what is the correlation maybe between blood clots and birth control pills?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we've known for a long time that certain birth control pills can increase the risk of having a blood clot a little bit. What's unique about what we saw with AstraZeneca, and I think it's the same thing with Johnson & Johnson, there's this rare cases where there's an immune reaction that affects your platelets and cause blood clots. It's very different than the kind of blood clots people get from, you know, having orthopedic surgery, a long car ride. It's really more of a rare, unique syndrome. And it does appear to be potentially hormonally related, because both in Europe with AstraZeneca and here in the United States with Johnson & Johnson, these rare occurrences have all been in women. There's an emergency meeting today of the Advisory Commission on Immunization Practices, that is a group that advises the FDA, and we'll see what they say about whether they think there's a connection or not. The fact that they paused out of an abundance of caution, I think it should give the public confidence that they're really taking this seriously and looking at it closely.
Doctor, what are you expecting to come out of that emergency session today that you just talked about?
Yeah, I don't know. It wouldn't surprise me if they decided to focus the Johnson & Johnson vaccine on people over 50 who are higher risk for COVID and lower risk for this rare complication. That would not surprise me. I think luckily in the United States, the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines are so safe and so effective, and we have a lot of those. And I don't think it's going to have a big impact in the short term. It's unfortunate. I'm concerned that this development is going to increase vaccine hesitancy. And should reassure people that, you know, much more than 100 million people in the United States have gotten Pfizer and Moderna, and no evidence of any problems so far.
Doctor, are you worried the pause on the Johnson & Johnson vaccine may further the hesitancy of people even getting a vaccine?
Yeah, absolutely. I think people that were concerned may see this as evidence that they should continue to be concerned. And just to repeat what I said, you know, the safety record of Pfizer and Moderna is so strong. I think 140 million Americans have received these vaccines. And the fact that people reported these potential adverse reactions of Johnson & Johnson should give people confidence that if the same adverse effects were being seen with Pfizer and Moderna, they would be reported and looked at. So our FDA and our CDC are very cautious, very careful. And I think that should give people confidence and the Pfizer and Moderna vaccine, and hopefully confidence in Johnson & Johnson once they work through this.
Let me ask you this. You think this is going to cripple Ohio's vaccination efforts and maybe even the sites, as we've been talking about those who are vaccinating, such as those who are maybe going downtown from the outskirts here, from different neighborhoods?
Yeah, I think they're going to have to replan. You know, the plan at the Wallstein was for the last 2 weeks just give the one-shot Johnson & Johnson vaccine. So we'll see what happens today. They may have to change those plans, or at least alter who gets the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. I think in the big picture, the supply of the Pfizer vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, is still very good. So I think it may slow things down a little bit, but it's not going to cripple us. You know, we're seeing the surge in Michigan. We're seeing a steady number of cases in Ohio. I think if we didn't have the vaccine in Ohio, we would be seeing many more cases. So I would encourage people to still get the Pfizer and Johnson & Johnson. Wait and see what happens with Johnson & Johnson. And just reemphasize, so far it's one in a million, so the actual risk is much lower than for someone, you know, over 50 of dying of COVID.
All right, and I have to wrap this up, but is this going to impact college students?
You know, it may a little bit. Again, I think that the good news is that Pfizer and Moderna seem to be able to increase their supply. So if Johnson & Johnson is slowed down or on hold, I still think we can move forward with the vaccines we have that are really remarkably effective and safe.
All right, Dr. Keith Armitage with UH Hospitals, we appreciate your insight. Thank you.